and he is reddish, not in the sense of the red like the European, but someone who is fair in color, but his hair is dark, black, and has been tanned by the sun, so looks like reddish brownish. So in that some races Adam and some of his red. The reddish is the reddish or brownish, or brown, which is healthy brown and tanned by the sun. And behind him, a man also, quite with the man, quite ugly, with one eye. And if you check all the narration, because there was a confusion with the scholar, which eye is really the awra or left. If you check the narration properly, the awra eye is the left one, which is flat and having like a thick cover. It's has grown, maybe it's born with that. Sometimes you say he loses later and then some kind of cover. Maybe the cover is an artificial one, like the one used by those one-eyed guys like Mushidaya. So this one is flat, and the right of his jacket is protruding and out, and ugly and big, and so on. But he can see through this one. So if he's a real man, then there's no need to do that. Some people say this is metaphorical for the Western civilization. I think this is just going on a board. They will be, we have seen leaders, for example, he's a different thing. We have small dajjals, like for example, George Bush. He's a small dajjal. How many people he killed and mischief he done in Iraq and Afghanistan? Several hundreds of thousands already killed. So we could have easily a leader who will kill several hundred thousand, and the dajjal can kill 10,000, 10 millions, easy. Even Hitler had Church obviously killed as much as Hitler, even more, although they put everything on Hitler. They killed millions. So you don't need to have the metaphor of war. And he started, it was like as a reformer. He claimed to be a prophet, that's definitely established by many Ahadith. But some Hadith say he started as a da'iyah for Islam. Then he graduated up one level. But we have a precursor for it, we have some preparation for that. We have, for example, Ghulam Qadiani, starting also as a great da'iyah of Islam, then graduating to a Mahdi, then graduating to a prophet, then graduating to a reincarnation of Isa, then graduating into utter nonsensicality. The same could happen with this man. He's just going level by level until he claims divinity, using all technology and science available to him, and all kinds of holographic images and satanic inspirations, and possibly a bit of witchcraft and things like that, but most likely doesn't need. So metaphorical, no, but like for example, you could say there's an allegation that I did not test it yet, probably how it is, that he has a donkey between his ear spans, something like 40 hand spans. The people could learn from that because they thought it's a real donkey and that the Dajjal is like a child. But it's not, but possibly this donkey is a riding animal. And what's have a span between the wings like 40 hand spans? Airplanes. So that could be very well possibly indicating airplanes in the language of that time or something like that. That you could say maybe metaphoric, I think, because no, he's a human being, and given his size, that he's is well built, bright shoulder, ugly, but quite forcefully built. So he's compared to Isa in the same region. We can't compare, he's just a normal human being. He even compared to someone who was known in Jahiliyyah, Abdul Uzza ibn Qatar, a one-eyed man who looks similar to the Dajjal, who died in Jahiliyyah. So. No, I think we should not, as a matter of general principle, we should not restore to a metaphorical explanation unless we are forced to, either by another evidence or by necessity of reason. Otherwise, it will open a door which never ends. I'll give you a simple example. For example, I once was, someone said, some of the extreme stupid Shia, not very reasonable Shia, saying that the ayah says, "Inna Allah yamurukum an tadbahu baqara," Allah commands you slaughter a cow, meaning slaughter Aisha. I tell him, okay, fine. Then we have in Surah, if someone was metaphorical without any reasonable or enforcing reasons, we have in Surah Al-Jum'ah, Allah said, "Those who carry the book of life, the donkey which will carry, the donkey is Ali." We said, "Aisha is the cow of Surah Al-Baqarah." I say, "Ali is the donkey of Surah Al-Baqarah." Or maybe it is the empire of China. No, it's just because it has no limitation. So metaphorical explanation must be having a good ground, and we must be forced. In the older books, in the Old Testament, the general rule is that metaphorical explanation is the way to go, because many of them, of the prophecies there, are dreams and visions, which are by their own nature metaphorical. We know that. We have plenty of dreams narrated by the Prophet as well as the Sahaba in the Ahadith, and it's clearly metaphorical. And the ones I'm used to interpret, they will ask people to interpret and correct them. We know that this is very common and very well established. But if it talks about entire personalities and so on, then the basic ruling is that it is a real person, it is a real event, and we should not distort a metaphorical explanation except we are forced to. Even my explanation that the Dajjal does is not miraculous, it's technology. It's not metaphorical, it's just benefiting from the knowledge we have now. 1,000 years ago, the people were unable to imagine that having invited technology according to their knowledge at that time. But we know now that we are almost closing in that technology nowadays to that situation. So now, I would advise anyone to abstain from this metaphorical explanation until he is forced to by either another evidence from the scripture or necessity of reason or clear circumstances like it is reporting a vision or a dream. Then we know dreams are by their own nature is bad and unfair. It is metaphorical by their construction. We know famous dream, the dream of Yusuf. He sees the sun and the moon and 11 stars being sujood for him. And it turns out that the son and the moon are his father and mother and the 11 stars are his brother. He never conceived that, but his father understood the meaning, general meaning that this one would be superior to his parents and to his brothers. Because he's a messenger to Egypt. His father was not a messenger, and the messenger is usually higher than a mere prophet. He felt that would be the indication. Yeah, that's the nature of dreams, but not if a prophet, especially the final prophet, who has been given the comprehensive speech and the exact, the correctness and the clearness of expression, not like previous prophets.
Are there any aspects which go beyond the physical nature of the job that the child has to that is the most important to move around and has certain forces of things with him, like, you know, life or religions, things like you already
explained? My best guess that we'll have the child may be better developed because I did not work on that intensively except recently, I did the badly more intensively, is that he will be maybe a ruler starting in Khorasan. That's also the hadith indicated coming from the east. And he will be possibly, but not necessarily, starting to claim to be either a man of peace who is mediating, or if one narration is correct, but it's not very strong, it's not, that he's a reformer calling for Islam, and possibly Muslim rulers after the Mahdi, after some time, will be a certain decline in level of application of Islam and piety, and claim, look at these guys, they are not doing that with the way they should be doing, like the Mahdi originally and the Qahbani, let me reform them back, and he will be able to come up to Iraq and settle in Kufa. That's what I say, this narration is questionable. And then later on, and he will have support from most Muslims and so on, so this is his first phase, if this narration is correct. But then after that, he will claim prophethood, that's when established, he will claim prophethood. I'm more inclined to that he will start claiming prophethood later in Khorasan. Earlier he would be a man of peace, mediating, possibly getting maybe the Peace Nobel Prize, like every criminal recently is getting the Peace Nobel Prize, and things like that. He would be a strong ally because he would be ruling mostly over people who have, what they call them, almond eyes and flat nose and so on. He would be a close ally of China, and the Chinese being the conservative nation they are, this is Gordon Magog, we'll verify that inshallah next time. They will be the one who is encouraging him to go out and start conquering the area, so that he can do their work without them being going themselves in warfare. All Chinese style, slow, patience, wait, do things to others, don't do it violently if possible. But then, after his demise, they will have no other solution except themselves to flood down the area with massive arms, and that will be their extermination in the hand of Isa. So he will be allied with major forces, but mostly in Middle Asia, mostly from the Turkmenic people, which, or the Ora Altai people, which include also Chinese, Japanese, Koreans, etc. So that's the power constellation, and you see the indication is going there. That area is becoming now slowly the dominant area of the world. Agriculture-wise, it has vast areas of agriculture. It has already nuclear technology. China is rising to become a world power within 30, 40, 50 years. The world power number one is already world power, but the world power number one in 30, 40, 50 years. And a few more decades, they will be capable of being, they already have been a formidable force. Already an enormous force now. You can see in the YouTube some military demonstrations and some parades. It is mind-blowing. Gokar Magog. So this is all obviously in the clear Vedic. All the conditions and signs are in that direction. But all that was narrated, some narrations say clearly that even the man who he killed and revived is not really killed. He's using some kind of maybe trickery or holographic images, maybe putting him in a room far away and just showing the people in television some kind of fake modified pictures. All of these technologies are available in our hands now. And if someone is having all this power and is such an enormous domain of power and capabilities, control of oil fields and so on, will be able to do that. Also the issue that he commands the clouds to rain and or not to rain. We already have that, we have already cloud seeding now. It's not perfect yet, but given a few decades it will become well under control. And if he's invested enough in that to exercise his power and control, that's it. So these things are looking at the conditions for that are becoming now really viable.
Last question.
Okay. Actually, the general priority in those talks I've given is that we start with the question most relevant to the topic of relevance. And there were some really good questions that were relevant, not really that relevant to the topic, but that people want to ask afterwards and more welcome. I would say the last one that there was a question here about the opinion of anyone to say, I don't know who he is. He's using the sample of those variables, the sample of those people that he's already out. Yeah, you've got this,
Who's name is mentioned? Emrah Hussain. Emrah Hussain is a recent character, maybe.
He's famous on YouTube.
Okay,
yeah.
What's his
statement for that? Well,
my Jews have already
come out. You've got this
thing. Because he got confused most likely about the three stages, because people, as I said, the classical scholars did not separate the hadith about the attacks of the people with flat nose, almond eyes, and round face, as if they are armored shields. But if you follow all the relations, but to classify them, you'll find three types, three different phases, actually. One is the attack which has followed, which has happened already. A second one is the one which was the jab, and most of his army like that, and obviously the cream, and the leadership will be of Jewish, especially the Jews of the East, and Jews of Asfahan, and so on, which are settling now in the area. The Jews are now major settlers that invested in Middle Asia. Again, an indication for things to come. And the third one is Ya'juj Ma'juj, and the hadith discovered them clearly with flat nose, malmoth eyes, and so on. So they mix the three attacks in one or two. But if you separate them finally and try to subdivide it, you will find that. And they did that in the Book of Tawheed, actually, as a part of the evidence of the Prophet, because the first one is happened already in the details which, for example, Ibn Mas'ud said, in the morning, if you want to cross the river to the other side, you pay only 1 dinar. In the evening, it will be 100 dinars just to cross over. So such a panic, and such people are running away. And that's exactly what happened at the time of the Mughal attack. It was so such when the attack came. And then he said, they will bind their horses in every masjid of the Muslims here along the rivers, from where you fight and figures. What happened also at the time of the Mughals. So all of these, all details, the horror, the running away, the people fighting to cross over, if they pay 100 dinars just to cross the river, all of that has happened. And this is the hadith of Allah ibn Saud, that there's no mention of Dajjal or Ya'juj Ma'juj in that one. So this is the first attack. So this is the man, most likely, he did not do a clean work of separating the three. But he is right that Ya'juj Ma'juj are really the cousins from this tribe, the Mughals and the Turkmenic people. That's correct. So these horror stories about Ya'juj Ma'juj being having one ear you can't use as a matras, as a cover, these are also fabricated hadiths, and people's imagination running wild, out of order completely. They are the human beings like you and me exactly, and you can just see in the YouTube any Chinese military parade, and you see the army by you.